Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back. I'm Alan Wong, the Executive Director of the China-United States Exchange Foundation. I want to first of all thank our partners, the University of Chicago and the Paulson Institute, for putting together the first U.S. China Forum. Yesterday, we had a very productive research workshop where climate change and energy experts from China and the United States discussed their findings and looked for opportunities for further collaboration. This morning, you have heard from our distinguished speakers on the common challenges faced by China and the United States on the environment and climate front. If I could borrow another mentioning of Secretary Paulson earlier this morning, he said, U.S.-China relations is the world's most important bilateral relations. This relation, managed well, will bring enormous benefits to the peoples of our two countries and to the world. The China-United States Exchange Foundation, which is a nonprofit organization based in Hong Kong, has an annual program of some 40 activities designed to promote better understanding between our two peoples. For details, you may refer to some of the pamphlets that we have placed under your seats. Today, we are very fortunate to have Madame Fu Ying as our keynote speaker. And for those who have just joined us now, let me introduce her again. Madame Fu is the chairperson of the Foreign Affairs Committee of the National People's Congress. And before taking her present position, she was ambassador to Australia in 2004 and later ambassador to the UK in 2007. And from 2009 to 2013, she was Vice Minister of Foreign Affairs. And in her unique position, she will give us her perspectives of the present state of our relationship and how to nurture this development. I'm sure you're all looking forward to her remarks. We are also fortunate today to have Mr. Steve Edwards, the Executive Director of the Institute of Politics at the University of Chicago, to moderate the discussion with Madame Fu Ying after her keynote remarks. So, ladies and gentlemen, please join me to welcome Madame Fu Ying.
Thank you, Alan, and Mr. Steve Edwards, and other distinguished members of the faculties and students, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great honor for me to address you here today. But I see in the crowd many faces looking like students from China. We were talking about it over lunch. I said it's a nightmare to speak to a mixed students because it's almost impossible to meet the expectation of the Chinese students and at the same time the students from other countries. When I was preparing this speech, I was thinking of American students or students from other countries. I'm glad to see so many students from China. I can't write another speech, so I will go back, go to the speech I prepared for. And if my fellow countrymen, women have particular questions, we can address it during the Q&A time. As the renowned architect Frank Wright said, eventually I think Chicago will be the most beautiful great city left on the world. But I wonder if you know that in China, I hope the Chinese students can prove it, in China, Chicago is more famous for its university, especially the parents who want to make their money worth are very attracted to this university, as this is a known place, as a place where fun has come to die. The great many musicians, scientists, and politicians were nurtured from this university, and I'm sure some of you will join them if you wish. And I give you my best wishes. And I guess most of the students in this university were born after 1990. And in China, they are called 90后, meaning the post 90 generation. And you share one thing in common wherever you are in the world. That is, you get the latest development in synchronization. For my generation, by the time I learned there is an operating mechanism called Windows, Bill Gates was already the richest man on earth. But now, trendy Chinese wait in tenderhook for the launch of every iPhone, new iPhone. And I remember Fast and Furious 7 was on the Chinese cinemas almost at the same time as in Chicago. So I hope I'm not too idealistic in thinking that since so much information is shared among the younger generation all over the world, shouldn't the young generation be more open and more ready to understand each other? Isn't it possible to find a new way to build a global order capable of ensuring lasting peace? When your President Obama spoke here on Father's Day a few years ago, he said, "The most important thing for the parents to pass along is the value of empathy, the ability to stand in somebody else's shoes and to look at the world through their eyes." In that regard, the first point I want to make today is about China's experience in the evolving world order. Dr. Kissinger's latest book, World Order, set off lots of discussions in China. It's absorbing to read the 400 years of rise and fall of powers since the Westphalia Peace Conference and the wars and conflicts that led to power shifting. However, the book also pointed out that Westphalian system was not universal. It was one of the many systems that coexisted and yet in isolation from each other, given the circumstances. Obviously, at that time, they didn't have internet. So, while in China, where history had been carried on for a long time, a different system of governance, values, and traditions were nurtured, which have an influence to the present day. So our view of history may have a different base. Let me pick up a few moments of history along the evolution of world order laid down in his book. As you probably remember in your reading, if you are reading politics, it was in 1648 Europe finalized the Westphalia Treaty to end the 30 Years' War, established a modern sense of order among nation states, recognizing their sovereignty and self-determination of internal affairs. Then Europe spread its colonial power to many corners of the world, including the United States, which freed itself and declared independence in 1776. I was reminded when I was writing this, I should use 76 instead of 1783. But this morning I had a conversation, a debate actually, with Professor Mills Hamer. He used 1983. Which was recognized by United Kingdom for US independence. I'm not getting into debate on that date. In this period, the long and the general peaceful relationship had continued. China's Qing dynasty was in its prime, and the population in the 18th century was more than the European countries put together. But this serenity for almost 2,000 years was broken when the European imperialists arrived in the middle of the 19th century. So by the time Versailles Treaty was signed in 1919, at the end of the First World War, most part of Asia was colonized and China's territorial integrity too was violated. By then, the last emperor of China had abdicated. The attempts by political elite to install a republic and Western-style parliamentary system had failed once and again, one way or another. The country was descending into chaos and conflicts, and young generation looked in other directions for solution. It was in this context that the Communist Party of China was set up in 1921 by a dozen or so young people, mostly in their late 20s, not much older than you. It's amazing how young people change the world. And on this point, I often have a debate with American colleagues because they like to see China through the experience with the former Soviet Union without knowing that in China we had a different history and different foundation. Fast forward to 1941, when Henry Luce of Time magazine stated the arrival of American century, two-thirds of China's territory fell under Japanese occupation and 35 million people died or wounded in the war. China this year will host a major commemoration in September to mark the 70th anniversary of the victory of the war against Japanese aggression. We'll remember the heroes, reflect on history and the value of peace. China and U.S. at that time fought on the same side and will never forget the heroic American pilots who helped China during the war. When peace did come in 1949 and the People's Republic was founded, the economy was on the brink. The average life expectancy was under 35 years. And more than 90% of the population was illiterate. I checked the statistics, 97% of people were illiterate by the year 1949. In other words, for many years following the end of the Second World War, when two major powers contested for world power, achieving a sort of a balance of terror, China, its main concern was its very survival, not least feeding its big population. There were many setbacks along the way in China, and I myself still remember the hunger and the confusion in my younger days. In the late 1970s, China's relationship with the world turned a new page, and mainland gained China's seat at the UN. And the policy of reform and opening to the outside world, led by Deng Xiaoping, enabled China to reconnect with the world economy. So when the Chinese talk about international system, we are referring to the institutions with the United Nations at the center and to which China has committed to ever since. Learned from its painful history, China believes in the principle of equality among all sovereign nations and non-interference in the internal affairs of other countries as enshrined in UN Charter. And Chinese President Xi Jinping, when attending the event marking the 60th anniversary of the Bandung Conference, reiterated the five principles of peaceful coexistence. So the reason I took you on this brief journey is to illustrate that when discussing world order, we should be mindful of different experiences of history and their impact on our perspectives. And we may sometimes feel not the same on certain things. So here comes my second point, how to look at China today. Now China has very much grown, but I have to say that knowledge and understanding of China in the outside world, especially in Western countries, hasn't grown at the same rate. A friend of mine who is a European journalist and a keen observer of China, he summed up the Western media reporting of China into the following three categories. China is either incredibly big, big population, big cities, even big demand for luxury goods. It sounds like the Chinese girls are buying most of the fashion bags. Or China is too bad, doing all the wrong things and not fitting into the norms. Or China is so weird, eating weird stuff and having weird ways of doing things. I receive many US Congress members who are often making their first visit to China. What strikes them the most is their encounter with the ordinary Chinese, such as the migrant workers they bump into visiting the Palace Museum, or the young makers whose ambition is to be the next Jack Ma of Alibaba. The ordinary Chinese people represent the true face of China, and they are the real driving force for China to grow strong and successful. So my third point is, what kind of future world order does China want to be part of? Is the future destined to be confrontation between China and the United States for world power, as some suggested? I often read memoirs of American politicians, and I'm always fascinated about how the U.S. is deeply and effectively involved in world affairs. Not only so, it's equally enthusiastic about the internal affairs of other countries. And one cannot help but wonder, is the prevalent understanding of world order amongst Americans a world dominated by U.S. rules and power? Is it only centered on American values and interests and supported by U.S. alliance? And does it mean that from the U.S. perspective, rising powers only have two choices, to submit or to challenge? What would the Americans do if they were in this situation? Professor Mills Hammer, if you meet him again, please ask him this question. This morning I asked him, he said, yes, submit or challenge. He said, why don't you just accept U.S. leadership? I said, fine, if they lead well. China is one such rising power. It has grown largely by marrying its natural advantages to the opportunities offered by globalization rather than flag before trade. Capital, markets, resources, and talents that had accumulated in Western countries since industrialization now have spread outwards due to globalization, and riding on that tide, China has made continued policy reforms and achieved 9% of growth for 30 years, allowing great improvement of people's living standards. So that's why you can see Chinese students studying in the U.S. sponsored by their own parents. I would never imagine it. When I studied in the United Kingdom, I was on the UK government allowance, which one allowance was shared by two students. So I only had enough to pay the lodging and a few remaining for the food and the one book a month. Now, China has already grown into the world's second biggest economy, and is the first trading partner to 130 countries, and even some predict that China's economy will be the world's biggest by 2020. And yet, international academics found, to their disbelief, that most Chinese are disinterested in the debate about new shifting of world power or power competition in the traditional sense. For us in China, we see inconsistencies at play. For example, if someone or some groups killed innocent people in Western countries, they are terrorists. Yet if the same thing happens in China, it's often viewed as ethnic or political issues by foreign observers. When China's neighbors act provocatively on territorial issues, the US turns its head away. And yet, when China defends its interests, it's described as either assertive or bully. If we cannot agree even on the most basic premises, how can we have a meaningful debate on the evolution of world order? In Guangdong, when people are talking past each other, they are described as having a dialogue between chicken and duck. China's focus remains the many domestic challenges, such as environmental pollution, fighting corruption, countering the economic slowdown, improving the livelihood of the people. The question of what future world order should look like on this issue, the discussions in China are more pragmatic. Though views still differ among us, one thing we all agree, that is the world has changed. Many old concepts have lost relevance. First, in today's world, it's no longer possible to have different world orders coexist independently of each other and addressing separate issues like in the past centuries. The orders of today need to open up and make adjustments to adapt to new realities and to different perspectives. But that takes time. According to Professor Miesheimer, the old structure, old system, or old order cannot open up. It's made that way. I'm only mentioning the part we discussed I disagree with. Actually, I agreed with many of his points. Secondly, it's no longer viable to try to achieve transfer of power and find new equilibrium through means of war among major powers, because the interconnected nature of today's world. And thirdly, what we are facing now are the new kinds of global issues which do not respect traditional order or sovereign borders. Look at Ebola, look at the ISIS, look at the boat people trying to cross from Africa to Europe. Therefore, there need to be new thinking to build a new global framework, or we may use the term global order to cope with new type of challenges. The good news is that as we enter the 21st century, mankind is already experimenting in an innovative and collaborative manner to tackle the new challenges, such as the G20 and the Conference on Climate Change, which we discussed this morning. For its part, China has initiated the Land Maritime Silk Road programs to strengthen Asian and Eurasian connectivity and is setting up the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank to support them. All these practices are complementary to the existing international system and will help with its gradual evolution into a fairer and more inclusive structure. Dr. Kissinger tellingly ended his book with a question mark: where do we go from here? Obviously, history has come to a turning point, and the question is in which direction it will turn. This question is also for China and United States. Do we have the resolve and wisdom to avoid the old loop? And can we build a new type of relationship and global order through cooperation instead of confrontation? That is why Chinese President Xi Jinping proposed to President Obama to build what he called China-US new model of major country relationship. Actually, in spite of the misunderstanding and stereotypes, China and US have already made close partnerships in many fields. We are even called reluctant twins. And the trust level is impressive too. Otherwise, how can we give each other 10 years visa? So what the young generation is inheriting in our relationship has more positive elements than negativity. To build a new model of relationship is an unprecedented endeavor for the two countries, and we both understand the importance of strengthening cooperation, managing differences, and create a stable strategic framework for peace and development of Asia, even the world. So this is the direction for our relationship, and is also our shared responsibilities. To end my speech, I want to say that evolving global order for 21st century is not going to be easy, and the answer takes time, and the world will count on the young generation, and I'm sure you'll come up with good answers. Thank you.
Let me start by going back to the notion that you described, this larger question of can we break into a new pattern for cooperation in the coming years? And I want to allude to the discussion in the morning around climate change, because we have seen a level of near-term success and growing cooperation around climate issues between the United States and China. To what extent do you think that could be a model for the way in which these countries engage in other policy areas?
I agree with many of the speech, the conversation in the morning and the discussions, and also during the lunch. I think this is a very, very important area, and it's also one of the rare areas we totally agree with each other. And we share the same difficulties, we share the same challenges at home, and we have the same vision for the future. That's why I think the agreement between the two presidents, President Obama and the Chinese President Xi Jinping, last year was very impressive. And this sent a very good signal to the world. It will pave the way for Paris.
Yeah. What are some of the other areas, as you look at the relationship, where you see opportunities for greater cooperation over the next, say, 5 to 10 years?
Generally speaking, I think in the economic field, in the financial field, in the real life field, we have lots of agreement. We have built 94 more dialogues, strategic dialogues, all kinds of dialogues.
90, over 90.
So I think we have the most dialogue channels with U.S. than with any country. So although there are differences from time to time, but generally speaking, I think the trend is healthy. There's more negativity in the political, in the security field. They're a bit lagging.
Yeah, I want to talk more about that. Where do you think that negativity comes from in the political and security field right now?
You want me to be straightforward?
Yes. You're here at the University of Chicago. It's a place for straightforward, rigorous analysis.
Okay. I've been in foreign affairs for a long time, since I was that young. And we've been listening to this finger pointing for 3 decades. And in 30 years, China has changed so much. China has progressed so much. But the finger pointing remains the same, except maybe the finger pointing is choosing different subject, but there is always this attitude. I think the root of this finger pointing or this negativity is the divide between us in ideology. I think U.S. has a system it's proud of, which is good. Countries should be proud of their success, and I'm sure the system works very well for the United States. But the problem is that U.S. think that everybody should copy it, and although they've done so much, to spread it and to for people to copy it without much success, but they are enthusiastic as ever before. So when it comes to the political system, the pressure on China is uncomfortable. I think that's one of the negativities.
You have characterized, I think, in a conversation with Henry Kissinger last year, the nature of the U.S. attitude towards China as one of anxiety. What do you mean?
That's a bit, all my American colleagues, friends, remind me to be careful on that. The glass heart needs to be cared for. I think it needs to be appreciated on the Chinese side as well. See, before the war on Iraq, China was one-ninth its GDP. China's GDP was one-ninth of the U.S. So China was way behind. And for U.S. was really on the top of the world. It was the strongest country. But at the end of the war, China was half of the U.S. GDP. So it was like a tall people growing up in no time. U.S. turned around and suddenly see China growing like that. So there is a, I think there is a, it's a question of accepting or understanding. And the political differences reinforces this sense of concern. But on the part of China, when I said there needs to be a kind of sense of appreciation, I think on the part of China, China does not have a, see, China look at its own growth from a different angle. We are 1.3 billion people, you are 300 million, more than 300 million. So although you see China growing so fast, second in the world, we the Chinese see the everyday life, it's the average. And in terms of average, we are far behind. And there is still considerable poverty in China. Sometimes I visit countryside in some rural areas. Not big changes have occurred. So there's a long way to go. So for China, we don't really realize the kind of shadow we throw on the world. So I think there is on one hand, it's understandable the U.S. is surprised and concerned. On the other hand, on the Chinese side, we don't see things that way.
And this idea of the shadow you throw on the world is not top of mind, you're saying, necessarily in the domestic environment.
That's
China.
Right.
Very
That's
interesting
right.
to think
That's
about.
That's right. I remember it's been quite a few years when I starting from 2010 when I came back, when I spoke to the Chinese audience of about this size, I always started my speech by asking from the crowd who think China is number two in the world. Number one is U.S., who is number two? Are we number two in the world? And there's no hands up. No hands up.
Really?
And it's interesting, my second question would be, if you don't think China is number two in the world, who is number two in the world? And then we see different views, very different. So people in China do not look at the world that way.
Well, I mean, you talked about this idea powerfully, I think, in the presentation about whether there might be an opportunity for a world order that looks different from the world order that we've known over much of the last 100 years, and certainly points beyond. A world order that actually either is unipolar or bipolar. So what are the ingredients that get to a different world order from your view? What would be needed? What's the kind of future world order that you think the United States, China, and the other nations on the planet should be working toward as we move deeper into the 21st century?
This is a sensitive topic at the moment. I think from the U.S. point of view, China is going to come in and challenge U.S., take over. and some of you want China to come in and take over, like in climate change. At the lunch, we talked about it. I don't remember the lady professor. She said China should take leadership.
In part because there's been a diminished U.S. investment in scientific discovery and in the monitoring of actual conditions on the climate. Yeah, she's concerned that no one will be there to fill the void. So China, please help, because I can't get the United States to do more on this. Yeah.
And I said China is allergic to the word leadership. because it's a sensitive topic. For the U.S. U.S. is from its own history, from its own mindset, as I explained in my speech. It believes that whoever is growing will come in and grab the power from U.S. U.S. does not realize that we are in a new horizon. Things are different. There are many new territories the current system is not covering. And Dr. Henry Kissinger also mentioned that the system U.S. believed in, the world order U.S. believed in, which, in which is a leader, never covered the whole world. And now we have come to the end of the rail with a train which has to move forward. So we must build new rails. It's not that China is going to take over from U.S. in the traditional sense. The traditional framework is not working. It's not coping all the problems. So let's move on. That's China's attitude. I don't think China wants to take over the role of U.S. in that way. As I mentioned in the memoirs of U.S. Former diplomats or politicians, U.S. is so busy about the world and poking nose into everybody's affairs. Well, that's not a role China would want to play. Because from our own history, our own experience, we suffered from that. We don't want to do the same on others. But there are areas, there are new areas. We have to work together, like climate change, like financial crisis. So what I'm saying today is that maybe we should have a global order, which finally is inclusive for everybody in, including the boat people. Everybody should be in. And then we have a system, we work together. If U.S. still wants to play the leadership, fine, go ahead. Yeah. But it has to be agreed. It has to be agreed by everybody and should be respected, and you need to win the leadership.
Yeah. Well, let me, you said that the United States likes to poke its nose in other people's business and that China doesn't, but there are people who would be listening here and elsewhere that might say, well, let's talk about China, for instance. Engaging certainly in lots of expansive trade relationships around the world. It's established the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. It certainly is building its military. It's doing more in the South China Seas, which the United States sees as threatening, as do some of its neighbors. So how do you square those observations and those moves with the idea that the United States is more prone to intervention in a way that China may not be?
It's a big jump. It will take me another hour. But normally, I read a lot of reporting here about China, and China is presented as a country which does not think things through. But I think U.S. when there are things the Americans or American media think is beyond comprehension, China is behaving weirdly. Maybe it's because you didn't have the complete information. Mm. Maybe there is an information gap that needs to be met, and then you will understand. That's one point. Secondly, on the Asian Infrastructure Bank, for example, there are lots of political stories around it. Actually, it's a very simple idea. You know, in the 90s, I was still working on Asia. There was this idea of Eurasian Bridge. I saw the map. Trains linking from Germany or Amsterdam all the way to Malaysia, Brunei. Beautiful map. But there was no money. It was just kind of a mirage. It was a very good plan, but hanging there. So China and ASEAN countries, we revisited the plan again and again. The railway ministers sometimes meet, but it was never put into, it was, I mean, it was very difficult to put into reality because of the cost, huge cost. And now China suddenly realized that we can do it. Maybe you can do it. We build a highway from Yunnan through Laos to Thailand. And the highway, on one hand, linked the three countries. On the other hand, allowed the poor villages along the roads to have a way out. Students went to schools, and housewives were able to sell what they produce. So it's a miracle. So if we can now, with a joint effort, start building this connectivity framework, network, it will benefit lots of people. But China, to do it alone is not possible. So it's an international practice to have a financial way, a commercial way of financing it. So the idea came for very practical purposes. And it's not easy. It's going to take years. It's a good idea, and there is only the possibilities, but not the realities yet. Yeah. And we do hope U.S. it's going to be good for U.S. too. We do hope U.S. will come on board as well.
Well, certainly the U.K., Germany, some 30 countries have signed on board. The U.S. has sort of kept at arm's length on this. What would it take, do you think, to get the United States more heavily involved in something like that?
Off the mindset. if U.S. has this zero-sum way of thinking about things, they create enemies in their own mind. They imagine threat, imagine enemies. I think in today's world, we're not going back to the 19th century, even 20th century. We are in the 21st century. We have to think about the real issues and to work together to tackle them. And if we succeed, it's going to be good for everybody. If we fail, we'll all lose. It's not easy. I know it's not easy. Having met so many American colleagues, it takes time. But we have to go in that direction. I don't think there's another way out.
Well, I mean, it seems at the heart of a lot of this is this question of trust, this trust gap that people have talked about around this. So, do you believe that there is a sort of trust deficit? And if so, how do we build that so that we're not questioning motives, we're actually looking at realities and responding to that in a more trusting way?
U.S. is a very interesting country. Talking about trust on China, some trust China very well, some don't. So it's
some in the United States.
Some, yeah, I mean, U.S. And for us, we must have trusted you. Otherwise, we wouldn't have so much money in your pocket. And you must have trusted us, so you give us 10-year visas. So there is a trust there. But there is also, in certain quarters, very little trust. So I think I would say in the real world, there is trust. In the imaginary world, the trust is lower.
Yeah, well, so how then do we strengthen that? And in what areas in particular? Do you think there could be better cooperation and trust building?
I'm optimistic. We've got more than 4 million people visiting each other every year. We have Chinese students right here. About 270,000 Chinese students in U.S. About 10% of that number in China, and the Americans in China are growing. The number is growing as well. I think time will tell. I'm optimistic. But in the meantime, we have to deal with the mistrust at the moment.
One of the areas where there is mistrust, certainly among some here in the United States, has to do with the increase in China's military budget and what its plans are from a defense spending, a defense strategy standpoint. They look at the increase and they say, that's proof yet again that we need to be concerned from a geopolitical standpoint about China. What is the Chinese philosophy regarding its increasing defense spending, and how do you view that part of the strategic imperative?
I don't think U.S. can come up with a figure, right figure, for China's right military spending. How much is right?
Yeah, yeah.
I think U.S. has to leave it for China to judge. And for China, it's very important we have the ability to defend ourselves. We learned it from history. A weak China is disastrous for the region, not only for China, for the region. And a weak China in future will be disastrous for the world. So we have to be able to defend ourselves. And our military expenditure was low for a long while. And then now we think it's a natural growth. If you look at the growth pattern of other countries, you find the same, almost the same route. But in the final analysis, it's very important that the Chinese defense strategy or defense thinking is defensive in nature, is provided in the constitution. So the Chinese military will play a very important role defending China. And in future, maybe, if the Chinese can think further, maybe one day we'll be part of the defense of the world peace.
What, in your view, what does the United States need to understand about the situation in the South China Seas? There's possibility that we could see U.S. naval ships in that perimeter more tightly. Obviously, Secretary Kerry was in Beijing earlier this weekend. That was sort of the subtext of some of the news coverage. What do we need to understand in the United States about China's view of the strategic relationship there?
I mentioned in my speech, I think U.S. needs to, if U.S. really cares about the issue, it really wants to play a role, it needs to have all the facts. For example, the tension between China and the Philippines, who made the first move, how and why? And if U.S. wants to say that China should leave it alone and give it up, that's impossible. That's unfair. If U.S. understands, maybe I hope U.S. can better control its allies to tell them not to provoke, because provocation invites reaction. That's a normal situation. Be surprised if China sits and watch and doing nothing when it's provoked. On the South China Sea issue, it's a complicated issue, but we did agree with our ASEAN neighbors that we shelve the disputes, we work for joint development. In the meantime, we maintain peace, and with the countries concerned, we try to negotiate to find a solution. And that pattern maintained peace and stability in the region for almost 20 years. So I think we should be able to work it out if there is no complication.
Well, just to further that point, then I'm going to take questions from everyone here. We talked at the beginning about the opportunity for cooperation in an economic sense, certainly, in a climate change sense. As you look out at the military relationship, how can our two militaries best avoid conflict in the future then?
The militaries themselves actually are having good dialogues, and they've already agreed at certain level about, I don't remember the exact term, it's a kind of a mutual warning or mutual notification over major events in the sea. I think they should, if they continue the dialogue, they should be able to find a way, because the common interest of the of the two countries in the Pacific is to maintain peace and stability. I don't think they want to, there's no reason the two military, two navy would fight a war. But it's important that they build trust gradually, and this sense of concern of each other, a sense of guard against each other can be gradually reduced or eased. Yeah.
Let's take questions from you. We have some microphones floating around, so put your hands up and we'll get microphones too. So we've got a hand in the back, we've got a number of hands right here, but I'll start over there. Yes, sir.
副部长，欢迎到浙大来。 Madam Fu Ying, welcome to UChicago. My name is Paul Wang. I'm a law school alum and also the president of the UChicago Beijing Alumni Club. As you might know, that many Chinese students have studied here, and some of them have made great contributions in China. For example, let's see, Wu Jieping, Ye Duzheng, Yang Zhenying, Li Zhengdao, and also recently a leading economist, Lin Yifu, also has done a great job in China. So my question is simple. What advice do you have for Chinese students who are studying here, and also for those who are applying to study here from China?
And I think what we'll do is we'll take a couple questions at a time. So we'll have you take, go ahead and give us your question as well. So advice for students studying in China and vice versa. And then, yes, go ahead and ask your question if you would.
Yes, and can I just say first, thank you very much for your gracious presentation and willingness to take our questions. But as you know, intellectual property is a huge issue. And would you comment on the way that you believe China and the U.S. could work together for an optimal outcome?
Great. And we'll do one more right up here. And then we'll go to those, and then we'll do a next round. Yeah.
So my question is, what role has the National People's Congress played in the reform since the Deng Xiaoping era?
Right. So we have three questions. We've got what role has the National People's Congress played in reforms since the Deng Xiaoping era? We also have questions about ways to improve the intellectual property relationships and preserve intellectual property rights, and a question about students studying abroad from each country, right, and advice to them. Which would you like to take up first?
In that order, the advice, I'm always careful advising other people's children. Because I can't even advise my own daughter. they wouldn't listen to me. But I think I really admire the great many people who were nurtured here. Especially those from China, they achieved a lot, and I'm sure you'll do the same. But one thing I think 90后, the after 90 generation, I think you have the advantage of having lots of choices. This is the first. If the 80s generation in China is the first generation which have food on the table. It's the first time the Chinese have a generation who grew up on a full stomach. And the 90 generation in China is the first generation which have choices. So I think you should appreciate that. And do see as much as you can, and learn as much as you can, and come back, and there is a lot for you to do. If you want to stay abroad, fine.
What about intellectual property?
Intellectual property, we've come a long way. It has long been a difficult issue. I think for China to build a sense of intellectual property, respect for intellectual property, it took time. But now we have very good law, very strict laws. We've learned from the U.S., from European laws, and we are, I think, being the latecomer, we have the advantages of taking the best from everybody. And we have even set up a special court on intellectual property So I think we've improved. We're a lot better, but it doesn't mean we're perfect. There's a long way to go. And U.S. and China often talk about it. Unlike 20 years ago, it was more difficult because we were so far apart from each other. And now I think the discussions is warmer and more constructive. And I think the world's satisfaction rate about China's intellectual property protection is a lot higher than before. For the National People's Congress, it's a long story. I'll try to answer it in two or three minutes. Deng, during his time, after the Cultural Revolution, after all those experiences and the chaos in the country, he said that we must have a political structure which will not be swayed, which will not allow our direction be swayed by individual will or the will of group of individuals. There is a firmer direction and track. So the National People's Congress was improved gradually. Its role, its ability, and also its power has been growing. I'm not saying that we are perfect, but now I think we are playing a stronger role, especially in law building, lawmaking. We're very busy, and we are amending old laws like environmental protection law. We had a law 20 years ago, but it was a law without teeth. And now we have amended it. It has become a very tight, very strict law, law with teeth. The penalty is very strict. So, and in the reform, I think the Congress plays a very strong role in reform, because the current reform, unlike years ago, when the reform first started, we have a famous saying, we cross the river by touching the stones, where the stone is. But now the water is too deep. Huh. You can't find the stone anymore. So we need a bridge, and the law is the bridge. So the National People's Congress have to go ahead of the reform steps and to prepare the ground with improved laws. Thank you.
Let's take some other questions. So we've got a hand, we got a couple hands right in the back. So we'll stay back here, and then I'll move up to these other sections.
Hello.
Yeah, it's on, it should be on.
It's on. Thank you, Madam Fu Ying. It was a pleasure listening to your speech. I am a student at the university, majoring in economics, a senior. And you talked about the real issues that we have to think about, and I definitely agree, and I think one of those issues is global warming. Recently, maybe you've heard in the news that Oxford University announced that they will limit their fossil fuel investments from their approximately 2.7 billion endowments. So my question is, what are the Chinese policies to meet the carbon cap set by scientists to sustain our world in upcoming 15, 20, 25 years, and what are being introduced by the Chinese government? And thank you very much again for being here and talking to us.
Great. So we got a question on climate change and carbon caps in particular, and what's happening in China. Let's take another two questions. Yeah.
Hi, man. My name is Zihan. I'm a fourth year university. I'm from China too, so it's very great to see you. I'm born in the 90s, and I have a lot of choice. I mean, UChicago is one of my choice. My question is, how will the Asian Development Bank change the diplomatic economic landscape in Asia-Pacific, particularly among the states that have territorial dispute? And I want to know what's your take on the Trans-Pacific Partnership.
Trans-Pacific Partnership.
Yeah.
TPP here.
TPP, okay.
And the first part of that was, say it again, the first part of your question too, so I make sure I have that.
The Asian Development Bank, yeah. What's the impact on the Asia-Pacific's landscape, and also to especially among the states that have dispute in territories?
Great. And one more? Yeah.
Hi, I'm Jing. I'm a third year at the undergrad in the college. My question is more personal. So as a female who's navigating very important political roles, where you're often in negotiations with some of the world's leading politicians, how do you navigate those in terms of particular challenges you had to even get to where you are now, and what advice would you have for other females who want to take on a more expanded role in terms of politics or leadership in general?
I think as a woman, I'm often asked of, the question of how do I balance family and the career, and is there advantage being a woman or disadvantage? I always say it's impossible to balance the role. We all have 24 hours. If I work overtime in the office, I'm not at home with my daughter. That's a fact. I can't create more hours for myself. So there is a sacrifice for any woman. I think women have two responsibilities, two jobs. A Korean woman, you work in the office and you work at home. So actually you have to do two jobs. So I always ask my colleagues to be sympathetic to my girl staff, because they have two roles to play. And for a woman, my experience is that it's impossible to ask for special attention just because you are a woman, because you are two roles. You are expected to do the same. So you have to try to balance it yourself. And my advice is, if you want to be a career woman, find a good husband who supports you. My husband spends more time in the kitchen than me. And second advice is to be nice at home. Always say the nice things. Always apologize. to be the wrong party at home. Always take the blame. It's not easy, and this is a man's world the facts. So a woman needs to be more patient, be more tolerant, and to see every challenge, every difficulty as a training for yourself, not to blame others. Always try to blame yourself, and then you will avoid the same mistake. So that's what I can think of at this moment. Now about the Asian Development Bank, how it's going to change the landscape. I think it's going to make us better connected if we can realize the connectivity plan. It will provide more opportunities for people in the remote area. In China, we have a saying that to get rich, first build a road. I think the most important thing the Chinese government has done is to have invested hugely in infrastructure. In the countryside, as long as you build the road, and the people will be able to find a way to improve their lives, improve their production. So infrastructure is badly needed in many parts of Asia, and if we can realize the connectivity initiative, the Silk Road Zone and the Maritime Silk Route, we should be able to help tremendously the people in Asia. Now about TPT, it's a very high standard new trade rule. And for China, I wonder if I've read that we are testing some free trade zones in Shanghai and in Tianjin and some other provinces as well, trying to implement or trying to bring ourselves one letter up. And at this moment, I think TPP is fairly beyond us. What is the other question now about global warming? I mentioned in my speech in the morning that China has done a lot. For example, one very important agreement we made with U.S. As I mentioned, the Chinese president, the U.S. president, agreed to take the leadership, to take the initiative, to move one step forward before the Paris conference by announcing a joint declaration on climate change. And under this agreement, China will peak its CO2 emission around 2030 and will try to make it happen earlier. And it will also increase the share of non-fossil fuels in primary energy consumption to around 20% by 2030. And the U.S. Has promised to achieve in 2025 an economy-wide target of reducing its emission by 26 to 28% below its 2005 level and to make best efforts to reduce its emission by 28%. I think it's we're setting a good example, and we hope the other countries will also make the right decisions so that in Paris we'll be able to make arrive at a binding agreement. I have other details I can email you.
Okay. Yeah, two thumbs up in the back. Okay, let's get some other questions here. We have a couple of hands here. We'll start here and then move back through. Yeah.
I'd like to ask you, I read that you were the translator at one time for both Deng Xiaoping and also Chairman Mao. And I'd like for you to just share with us the similarities and differences between those two leaders.
Great question. Great question. And we'll do right here, and then we'll go to the back. Yes, Deli.
Madam Chairwoman, you addressed already to some extent the concerns about the distrust between the two countries, especially the issue that there have been people who in the United States who don't trust China as much. But in the US, there's also quite a bit of interest and in fact concern about the people who show distrust in the United States. They tend to be very critical, sometimes in very nationalistic tones, and in fact tends to worry about everything the US does towards China, is trying to undermine China. Could you address that aspect of the equation? Thank you.
Great. And we'll do back here. We'll take a third one. Yes.
It's a great honor to see you here, and it's a great delight to hear your presentation. I'm from China myself. Related to the questions that this sir here just asked, corresponding to the growth of Chinese economics and international prestige, there is also a huge rise of nationalistic sentiments in domestic China, and in issues such as the disputes in Southern China Sea, what the Western world regarded as aggressive behavior of Chinese government is regarded by many people in domestic China as not going far enough. So my questions would be that to what extent would this rise of nationalistic sentiments affect China politics and reforms in domestic China, as well as how would Chinese government reconcile the two conflicting opinions from domestic and international communities, to how would these conflicts shape Chinese foreign policy in the future? Thank you.
Great questions. And let's actually continue with the reverse order, because I think those last two questions clearly relate, one from a domestic Chinese perspective, the other sort of how our own internal politics in the United States trigger different reactions within China.
So you want me to take the last one first. I'm impressed with the question. I hope one day you'll sit in the seat and try to reconcile the two. It's a very sophisticated question. But I don't feel comfortable when people refer to some of the Chinese views as nationalistic. if like in the U.S., it will be, they will be patriotic. I think the Chinese are very patriotic. Nationalism, the term has a special meaning. I don't feel comfortable putting that hat on many Chinese young people, many Chinese scholars who talk about the China's national interest. So I hope there is a better distinction, number one. Number two, it is true that the pressure from the world and pressure from China are in two directions. So it is difficult, on the one hand, to try to explain to the international audience, to the United States, that that's our interest. We have to defend our interests and to persuade our neighbors that the better way is to shelve the disputes. On the other hand, the domestic pressure is for China to be stronger and to be able to defend our interests. Since we own them, why don't we take them back? So it is a difficult issue. I think as a diplomat, I talk in both directions. I think the policy has to be made with the pros and cons, always choosing the best line. Especially when China is stronger, when we talk about our own interests, we defend our interests, we should also be aware that sometimes our effort to defend our own interests may go against the feeling or the effort of other countries. So there has to be if we don't see each other as enemies, we have to try to find a way to find a way to be able to persuade the others and to find a peaceful solution. I think China should not just because there are different pressures, China should not move away from its own belief that we should always try to resolve disputes with our neighbors through peaceful means. Yeah. That's the underlying principle. Now, the difficulties is not always with our neighbors. We have lots of private discussions with our neighbors, lots of retreat discussions with ASEAN group. But the difficulties comes when U.S., which is not an interest party in the disputes, apparently taking sides with some of our neighbors, especially when the neighbors, who is the ally of U.S. and provoked China, and the U.S. appear to be standing behind them. I think that would complicate the situation, which is not wise for the United States. And if U.S. wants to intervene, if U.S. wants to not intervene, I don't think intervention is welcome, but if U.S. want to take a view or take a position, it's always wise for U.S. to hear both sides of the story and to find out the clear facts. Otherwise, it may make a misjudgment.
On the second question, I just wanted to add, because I think that this is a reality that exists in U.S. domestic politics and will only increase as we move into a presidential election, where China will become a topic of conversation in debates between candidates on both sides, and people will be offering a range of postures from hardline strategies to more cooperative strategies. And on that hardline view, I think Professor Yang's question speaks to this, how that plays inside of China, and if there's too much adherence and too much value placed in that. Is that a fair characterization of what you were saying?
There is that, but there is also sort of certain line within China that seems to take an even harsher stand.
Yeah.
And so in that sense, it's the best way in particular.
Yeah. Yeah.
China has grown out of a difficult past, and China is fairly new on the international stage. So China is developing views and positions, perceptions of the world, sometimes vis-a-vis how China is treated, how China is viewed. So criticism of China, if unfairly made or perceived as unfairly, would invite reaction in China. I sometimes tell my American colleagues that they should be mindful when they talk about China, there might be more Chinese reading that than Americans. So they need to be aware that there's another audience, and they need to be careful in what they say. I'm not saying that they shouldn't criticize China. If they do, they have to be based on facts, real facts. So I think we should gradually learn that not every individual American, if not every American politician represent the country.
Mm.
There can be different views. Likewise, I think in China there are different views, so we shouldn't take those extreme views too seriously. But during the U.S. elections, if China becomes a target, I was told by many, we are advised that we should not take it too seriously. It's an election, for election purposes. Some people just talk for the sake of talking, for the sake of winning more votes. But I worry if in a country, demonizing China gain more votes, some very healthy phenomenon, number one. Number two, it does make effect on the U.S. image in China because they are heard. So U.S. politicians also need to be careful. This is a partner you are going to work with. There is a big population there. And the literacy rate in China is very high. People read. So I think there should be more respect. If we switch positions, if the Chinese politicians keep on attacking US for the sake of gaining what you call nationalism support, nationalist support, how would you feel? Mm. I don't think it's wise. In 21st century with the media like this, politicians really need to be aware of the bigger audience. Mm.
And then comparisons and impressions of your work with Chairman Mao and Deng Xiaoping.
I did interpretation for Deng Xiaoping on a very few occasions. That was his later years. I never did for Mao. I'm not that old. but they are both great men, great, great people, and great for their own times.
We have time, I think, for just a couple more questions. We have a lot of hands right in here, so let's get some microphones. We can start here in the front, and we'll move it straight to the back. Yeah.
Nihao, Fubu Zhang. I'm from Renmin University. I'm an exchange student here. I do have a question in terms of internet. We all know that internet in China is still under control. And I do believe that internet should be controlled and should be have some regulations. I wonder how internet would play a role in the future and your vision about internet and how internet would affect China and U.S. relation. Okay.
Right. We'll go right next to you.
Thank you very much, Madam Fuying. I'm also from China. I'm from Shanghai. I'm a first year here studying economics. As a Chinese student studying in the United States, I have a lot of friends who are from the United States, and they have they're viewing China as a rising power instead of a rising friend, which I felt is very pity because I really want to be friends with them. And I think this image might due to some difference in the ideology between China and America, and also some instances, for example, the regulation of the internet. So how do you think, as a Chinese student studying here, can we do something to promote this mutual understanding between China and America? Because that would be really helpful, I think. Thank you very much.
Terrific. And yeah, we'll do this question, the one in the final final row there, the woman in the back, yeah.
Well, thank you so much for coming. I'm Harrison Yu, I'm a fourth year here. My question was in regards to Hong Kong. Historically, Hong Kong has been a gateway into China, first through manufacturing and then through finance. My question for you is, what do you see, well, recently we've seen that Shanghai has become, it's taken over more of a role as an international financial center from Hong Kong, and many financial analysts see that Hong Kong's relevance will be diminished. What do you see Hong Kong's role in the future, especially after 2047, in regards to China's strategic utilization of Hong Kong?
And there was a question this woman had in the back.
Thank you, Madam Fu. It's my honor to ask you a question. I'm a visiting scholar here in UChicago, and today many of my friends refer to me that they just come here to see an attractive woman, you. So, but I'll skip the question of how to keep attractive as a political woman, but turn to the question of how to keep attractive as of our motherland, because we have many workshops here, and then when we have a fierce discussion, when we turn to the divine ideology, political ideology, we will go no further. So I agree that the most negative points between the US and China could be turned to be the divine ideology. So could you give us some advices of our political communication to keep our attractiveness and to resolve this problem? Thank you.
So we have four questions. We'll try to get to them as swiftly as possible as we just have a few minutes left here. That last one, really, advice on political communication to move beyond or to deal honestly with ideological divides and improve relations between the country. Question about Hong Kong's future role in China, internet regulation, and maybe we could end on the Chinese students point and use that on both sides, Chinese students in the U.S. and U.S. students in China. Let's start with that last question, though, around political communication.
I stopped over in New York, and we had a round table in Asia Society, and it was a very heated debate about internet. My Gmail was not working when I was in China, so I opened other accounts. And when I'm here, the other accounts was very slow, impossible, so I switched back to my Gmail. So it's unfortunate that there has to be this kind of situation. And I hope at the political level, the trust will grow. And China is at the receiving end of this political pressure. So so China is on the defense in a sense. But China and some other countries have proposed to have an international code of conduct or code of rules vis-a-vis the internet, because the internet is a new domain. It's a new domain. There's a sovereignty, there's no sovereignty. There's sovereignty, there's no boundary. And US has the strongest, the best technology on the internet. So I hope that China, US will somehow agree. Instead of blaming each other, instead of defending war, maybe one day we can, hopefully your generation should build friends among your colleagues, and one day we can have a better arrangement, and the world needs a common rule, a common code of conduct in new territories like this, not only on the internet, like in the space, in the polls. So I hope the future can be more satisfactory.
In the interest of time, I might suggest that we do the Hong Kong question, then we bundle those last two as kind of a larger question. Does that seem fair? Well, Hong Kong next.
I think there was a worry about competition first between Hong Kong and Singapore, and then Hong Kong and Shanghai. Actually, I don't think there need to be such a worry. Asia can have many financial capitals. It's really for Hong Kong, if Hong Kong can really live up to the new expectations. So, and Hong Kong has a lot more advantages than the other cities in China. Shanghai is still trying to catch up, but Hong Kong is more international and have a longer history and better experience. I'm not very worried on that. But Hong Kong does confront with the challenge of how to renew its competitiveness in all fields. So that's something Hong Kong needs to work on. But the success story after the return of Hong Kong gave the inland and Hong Kong lots of confidence for the future development. So what's next?
Last question we'll combine, and I think they both relate to the advice that you would give to what we as individuals, I think in particular there was a question about Chinese students in the United States, but what I think all of us can do to help strengthen relations and move beyond the divides culturally and ideologically and politically that animate much of the relationship that we've been talking about today.
When I was in London, I come across many Chinese students who are frustrated at what they read on the newspapers about China. It's not the China they grew up with, and they don't understand in the modern internet stage how come the Western world, so developed, do not know what's really going on in China. It's really frustrating for them. My answer to this, I share the frustration, but I would say that it's no use blaming others. We have to try to look at ourselves. Why? And I think China has not been capable enough projecting its own image, explaining to the world timely. On South China Sea, for example, the story is clear, but outside world think China's a bully. So we it shows that we have not been explaining forcefully enough or timely. And China, we the Chinese know that in China, Confucius said, man should be swift in action, slow in words. We tend to believe in doing things, not in saying things. But now in the modern world, doing things is not enough. You have to say it well after you've done it well. So I think we need to improve our own ability, and we need to be able to explain. So when you confront with people, you can't convince them, you should come back and check your own narration, your story, and then see gradually. Never give up. I think we have to be part of the world, and this is our world as well. We have a place here, so we shouldn't give up. We should keep on working, trying to be able to project our image by ourselves, not have our image being projected by others. So that's my hope for the new generation, and also. Try to go beyond the differences and find the common grounds. I think the fact you are here is a good story. It's already a big improvement.
China. Well, that's a fitting note to end on. I want to thank all of you for your great questions. Madam Fu Ying, thank you so much for spending time with us and sharing your insights. We greatly appreciate it.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Fu. That was one of the greatest sessions I think I've had like this. Really, really wonderful. I think if I could be as wise as Confucius, I'd have something to say about the power of your words. But I'm sure you touched many people here and have influenced the way they think about China, about the US, and about our very important relationship. So thank you very much. And thank you, Steve, for being a wonderful moderator. I think it's been a wonderful day of inquiry and building knowledge and understanding. We've had the opportunity to dig deeply on the issue of climate change and also look broadly at the larger U.S.-China relationship and also politics. Today's conversation is built upon some focused conversations and sessions that took place yesterday between visiting scholars from China and faculty at the University of Chicago. And I hope that these conversations over these 2 days will lead to many more opportunities for collaboration, lasting relationships, and impact. I think most of us in this room recognize that the U.S.-China bilateral relationship will be among the most consequential in our lives for the global economy, for the environment, for the careers of students in this room, for the potential of science and research to tackle the big challenges, the prospects for peace, the promise of sustainable development and eradicating poverty. Serious, open, frank exchanges like we've enjoyed today provide an important foundation for this cooperation, collaboration, and long-term friendship. So we look forward to continuing this conversation with you in the days, weeks, and months ahead. Many of them will take place here in Hyde Park. Others will take place at the University of Chicago Center in Beijing and our new center in Hong Kong, and of course with partners and friends across China and across the world. I want to offer, and of course, next year we'll host the second annual forum like this, thanks to our very great support and partnership with the China-U.S. Exchange Foundation and its executive director, Alan Wong, who's here today. So let me give a special thanks for CUSIF, for EPIC, Michael Greenstone and his team, the Paulson Institute here on campus, and to many others who helped make this day a reality. I want to single out, you know, Michael and Carmen and my team for their great work, as well as Vicky and Pete on Michael's team, who really went above and beyond, and the folks on Alan's team in Hong Kong. And thanks to all of you for your interest in these important issues and interest in among the most important relationships of our time. That concludes today's forum. Thank you very much. See you again.